Random House Audio presents Fangs, The Vampire Archives, Volume 2. Edited by Otto Penzler. Read for you by Peter Altschuler, Scott Brick, Erik Davies, Susan Denaker, Susan Duerden, Stephen Hoye, Carrington MacDuffie, Robin Sachs, Simon Vance, Bob Walter, and Steve West.
Introduction by Otto Penzler. Read by Bob Walter. While Bram Stoker's outstanding Victorian novel Dracula is certainly the most famous vampire story, it is not the first, having been preceded by John Polidori's The Vampire in 1816. This story was invented in perhaps the most significant single moment in the history of supernatural literature. As Gordon Lord Byron read Christabel, Samuel Taylor Coleridge's vampire poem, to his friend Percy Bysshe Shelley, his wife Mary Wollstonecraft Shelley, and their physician Dr. Polidori, he challenged the group to come up with an equally frightening story. Mary Shelley conceived the story of Frankenstein that night, and Polidori, clearly an untalented hack, was inspired to write the first English-language vampire story, which is, alas, far too tedious to include in this collection. None of these works to any significant degree inspired Stoker to write Dracula, an honor that fell to the great author of macabre fiction, Sheridan Le Fanu, whose novelette Carmilla in 1870 featured a lesbian vampire with the ability to transform herself into a gigantic cat, scandalizing Victorian readers. The great Gothic tradition of ruined castles and abbeys, whose rooms and crypts serve as resting places for vampires, is well represented in this audiobook. There are numerous spires, clouds passing in front of full moons, handsome men in full evening dress, coming to bite the necks of beautiful and innocent young women in the dead of night, and coffin lids being raised to reveal their horrible residence. But vampires come in many guises, and they are here too. Some that look pretty much like the rest of us, some who have frustrating, even occasionally humorous, difficulties, and some who are not interested in blood at all, merely wanting to suck the life out of their victims in a metaphorical way. There are stories here by men and women, from every literary era of the past century and a half, right up to the most talented writers of the present day. There are familiar classic stories here, and a few that you are unlikely to have encountered previously. No matter whether you decide to approach listening to this audiobook in small bites or as a gigantic feast, I hope it provides you with a bloody good listen. Down Among the Dead Men by Gardner Dozois and Jack Dan. Read by Bob Walter. Bruckmann first discovered that Wernicke was a vampire when they went to the quarry that morning. He was bending down to pick up a large rock when he thought he heard something in the gully nearby. He looked around and saw Wernicke huddled over a Mussulman, one of the walking dead, a new man who had not been able to wake up to the terrible reality of the camp.
"Do you need any help?"
Bruckmann asked Wernicke in a low voice. Wernicke looked up startled and covered his mouth with his hand, as if he were signing to Bruckmann to be quiet. But Bruckmann was certain that he had glimpsed blood smeared on Wernicke's mouth.
"The Mussulman, is he alive?"
Wernicke had often risked his own life to save one or another of the men in his barracks, but to risk one's life for a Mussulman.
"What's wrong? Get away."
"All right," Bruckmann thought. "Best to leave him alone." He looked pale. Perhaps it was typhus. The guards were working him hard enough, and Wernicke was older than the rest of the men in the work gang. Let him sit for a moment and rest. But what about that blood?
"Hey, you! What are you doing?"
one of the young SS guards shouted to Bruckmann. Bruckmann picked up the rock and, as if he had not heard the guard, began to walk away from the gully toward the rusty brown cart on the tracks that led back to the barbed wire fence of the camp. He would try to draw the guard's attention away from Wernicke. But the guard shouted at him to halt.
"Are you taking a little rest? Is that it?"
he asked, and Bruckmann tensed, ready for a beating. This guard was new, neatly and cleanly dressed, and an unknown quantity. He walked over to the gully, and seeing Wernicke and the Mussulman, said,
"Aha! So your friend is taking care of the sick?"
He motioned Bruckmann to follow him into the gully. Bruckmann had done the unpardonable. He had brought it on Wernicke. He swore at himself. He had been in this camp long enough to know to keep his mouth shut. The guard kicked Wernicke sharply in the ribs.
"I want you to put the Mussulman in the cart, now."
He kicked Wernicke again, as if as an afterthought. Wernicke groaned but got to his feet.
"Help him put the Mussulman in the cart,"
the guard said to Bruckmann. Then he smiled and drew a circle in the air, the sign of smoke, the smoke which rose from the tall gray chimneys behind them. This Mussulman would be in the oven within an hour, his ashes soon to be floating in the hot, stale air, as if they were the very particles of his soul. Wernicke kicked the Mussulman, and the guard chuckled, waved to another guard who had been watching, and stepped back a few feet. He stood with his hands on his hips.
"Come on, dead man. Get up, or you're going to die in the oven,"
Wernicke whispered as he tried to pull the man to his feet. Bruckmann supported the unsteady Mussulman, who began to wail softly. Wernicke slapped him hard.
"Do you want to live, Mussulman? Do you want to see your family again? Feel the touch of a woman, smell grass after it's been mowed, then move."
The Mussulman shambled forward between Wernicke and Bruckmann.
"You're dead, aren't you, Mussulman?" goaded Wernicke. "As dead as your father and mother, as dead as your sweet wife, if you ever had one, aren't you? Dead!"
The Mussulman groaned, shook his head, and whispered,
"Not dead. My wife."
"Ah, it talks," Wernicke said, loud enough so the guard walking a step behind them could hear. "Do you have a name, corpse?"
"Josef, and I'm not a Mussulman."
"The corpse says he's alive," Wernicke said, again loud enough for the SS guard to hear. Then, in a whisper, he said,
"Josef, if you're not a Mussulman, then you must work now. Do you understand?"
Josef tripped, and Bruckmann caught him.
"Let him be," said Wernicke. "Let him walk to the cart himself." "Not the cart," Josef mumbled. "Not to die. Not. Then get down and pick up stones. Show the fart-eating god you can work." "Can't. I'm sick. I'm
Mussulman."
Josef bent down, fell to his knees, but took hold of a stone and stood up.
"You see," Wernicke said to the guard, "it's not dead yet. It can still work." "I told you to carry him to the cart, didn't I?"
the guard said petulantly.
"Show him you can work," Wernicke said to Josef, "or you'll surely be smoke."
And Josef stumbled away from Wernicke and Bruckmann, leaning forward as if following the rock he was carrying.
"Bring him back!"
shouted the guard, but his attention was distracted from Josef by some other prisoners who, sensing the trouble, began to mill about. One of the other guards began to shout and kick at the man on the periphery, and the new guard joined him. For the moment, he had forgotten about Josef.
"Let's get to work, lest they notice us again," Wernicke said. "I'm sorry that I..."
Wernicke laughed and made a fluttering gesture with his hand, smoke rising.
"It's all hazard, my friend, all luck."
Again the laugh.
"It was a venial sin,"
and his face seemed to darken.
"Never do it again, though, lest I think of you as bad luck." "Karl, are you all right?" Bruckmann asked. "I noticed some blood when..."
"Do the sores on your feet bleed in the morning?"
Wernicke countered angrily. Bruckmann nodded, feeling foolish and embarrassed.
"And so it is with my gums. Now go away, unlucky one, and let me live."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.